that's not right. 180, I'm sorry. 180. Good evening. We want to welcome you to Tri-State Baptist Temple. Take your hymn book. Turn to hymn number 180. Hymn 180. We'll stand together and sing, "All Hail the Power." So glad you're back tonight. We heard such a great message from God's Word this morning, Psalm 107, and just learning that we could cry out to the Lord. I appreciated that. I hope you did as well. And we're looking forward to hearing from the Word of God again tonight. And so we're glad you're here. We want to have a word of prayer, ask the Lord just to bless our time together, and just that He would be glorified in all that we do here tonight. So Brother Watts, will you pray for us, please? Yes. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated and we'll listen to our choir.
Worthy of all the good songs we
Amen. Our choir is going to come down. We want you to stand, and we're going to fellowship a little bit here this evening. Amen. Well, you can be seated this evening, and we want to say welcome to you again. We're glad you're back tonight, Tri-State Baptist Temple, and again, we had a great time this morning, and we appreciated a great message from God's Word, and so good to have a baptism, see Daniel be baptized, and just continue seeing the Lord work in the life of our church. And so we're excited about it, looking forward to all that the Lord is doing. I'm excited about hearing more good preaching tonight, and excited about just the chance to be together around the Word of God. So we're glad you're here today. Our teenagers are going to go to Mark and Kathy's house in a little while and eat some good food and just hang out and play some games. And Josh is going to have a devotion for us, and we're going to have a great time. And looking forward to time together. And at our snack, Parker's been gone in Florida on us, and so he's back with us today. And looking forward to being together. And so we're so thankful that our church loves our teenagers and loves our youth group, and wants to invest in them, and wants to be a part of what's going on in their lives. People often say that the youth group, the children, church of the future, all those kind of things, and while that is certainly a true statement, it's also true that they're a part of the church now. And it's very clear at our church that our teenagers have an impact on the work of the Lord right now in their life. And so I'm thankful that our church believes in that and invests in that and gives us the opportunity to reach teenagers. And so I'm thankful for that. So we're going to have a good time this evening at our snack, and we're looking forward to that. Yeah, I tried to get by that real fast. It didn't work, did I? I used to do that all the time when I preach, but I didn't know it. And so everybody would laugh while I was preaching. And I'd ask Mom, I said, I didn't say anything funny. Why was everybody laughing? And, you know, and so So it would always be something like that. And when I thought I was going to be funny, nobody would laugh, right? And so I learned there's no need for me to try to be funny because I'll make enough mistakes people will laugh at me and they'll get to laugh during the sermon. So that's all right. But anyways, we're glad you're here. Don't forget about Vacation Bible School. We met right before the service with our helpers, and we're looking forward to Bible School. We're praying that God is going to do a great work. We're praying it's going to be the best year of Bible school we've ever had. We mentioned that this church has been having a week of Bible school every year for probably longer than I've been alive, I'm sure. And we're thankful for that. And we're excited about that. But we don't want this just to be another week. It's easy to go on. I told them I could hit play on Monday and just coast through the week, make it all happen because I know what all is supposed to happen. I've done it so often now, but there would be no power in that. There would be no value in that. We need the power of God. We could do a lot of things in our power, make a lot of things happen. We could bring in crowds and have fun activities and all those kind of things, but there's no power if we don't have the Lord Jesus Christ in the middle of all that we're doing, if we're not relying on Him. And so we want to have the most successful week we've ever had at Bible school. And so to do that, we've got to humble ourselves. The Bible says when we are weak, then we are strong. And so when we'll realize who we are, realize who He is, and just humble ourselves before His feet, I believe the Lord will do a great work. And so we're expecting next week at Bible school for the Lord Jesus Christ to save souls. And we want to be prepared and be ready to share with them His word so that He can do the work that only He can do. So don't neglect to pray for Vacation Bible School. Be here, be a part. Maybe you've not signed up, you've not come to the meetings, any of that kind of thing, but you thought, you know what, I need to be in on that. Just come and I'll find a place for you. We've got plenty and you can be a help to us. If you can only come a night or two, come and I'll find a good place for you to fill in and be a help to us. You can have an impact on souls. It's what we want you to be a part of. But don't neglect. Everybody can be praying every day for what we're doing in Bible school. So don't forget about that. Tomorrow is our next ladies' Bible study. I want to encourage all of our ladies to come be a part of that. It's going to be a great time. Lydia, my wife, is hosting that at our house. 6 o'clock tomorrow evening. So we want you to come and be a part of the ladies' Bible study. It's for our teenagers as well. Teenage ladies and our adult ladies, come and be a part of our ladies' Bible study, and you will enjoy that time together. And this week on Friday, we're going to have a Vacation Bible School outreach. We're going to have, sometimes we call it a VBS Blitz. We've called it all kinds of things, but the idea is to get as many of our church family as possible to come Friday, and we're going to go as far, pass out flyers and invitations to Vacation Bible School to as many places as we can so we can get more boys and girls here to hear the gospel. We have strategic places that we go where we can hit a lot of doors very quickly, and so the more people we have, the farther we can go, obviously. Pastor Tim has maps upon maps upon maps of areas in our community that we could go, but we can only cover them all if we have enough help, enough people that are interested in souls. And so we want you to come and help us to pass those things out. And again, everybody in the room can be praying Friday night for what's going on. We need you here. We need you to put your faith and prayer into action and be a part of what's going on. But we need everybody to pray that the Lord will go before us and help us reach these boys and girls. And so don't miss out on those things. And I'm sure I'm missing some things, but we're excited about all that's going on. We hope you'll be involved, and I hope you'll be excited about what the Lord is doing. He's working in our church, and it's exciting. So we want you to be in on all that. So we're thankful to be here today. Well, at this time, we'll ask our ushers to come. We'll take up tithes, offering, faith, promise, missions, offering again this evening. Come right ahead. Come right ahead. Amen. Normally on Sunday night, it's Jason and Victor. So you're Victor today, I guess. All right. All right, let's pray together. Amen. Amen.
Well, it's a blessing to see everyone here tonight, wake everybody up again. But we're glad you're here. It's been a great day, and we're thankful for all the things the Lord is doing, and we're excited about it. Vacation Bible School is important. It's one of our big last big ministries of the summer, and we want to try to reach as many children as we can. We've got a great series of Bible lessons, just good foundational truths for boys and girls that we want to share this year. And Friday night, this coming Friday, is an important night for us. Every teenager we got, we need your help. And every family we have, we need your help. Nobody goes by themselves. You'll be in groups of people. Evan mentioned we have some places that we have just marked off with maps. And you'll have a copy of that map. You can go out, knock on a door. You'll have some nice literature there that people can see. And just introduce yourself. My name's Tim. I'm from Tri-State Baptist Temple. Monday night, we start Vacation Bible School. And if you have some children or you know someone would like to attend, we'd love to have them. And we have transportation. We can pick them up anywhere in the community. And they're either going to be interested or not, yes or no. If they're indifferent, leave the information. They may be excited. They may be ready to go. That map you have is going to have a corresponding door number, trailer number, apartment number, whatever it may be. All you need to do is put a check mark by that and say, yep, that's where our bus workers need to stop Monday night, and we'll take it from there. But we need help with that. We need feet on the ground, out in the fields. And we're thankful for the normal bus workers we have, but there's only so much they can do. And what a privilege to labor together with the Lord. And so we need you to come out and give us a hand. If you need a ride to get here, teenagers or whoever it is, we'll get you here. We need your help. So that's a big night for us on Friday night, and that's at 6 p.m., and we'll meet in the ministry center. And so many other great things going on, and you know, my mind's always running ahead. I'm in the moment, but I'm also beyond Bible school. And when I'm thinking about homecoming, I'm thinking about missions conference, and I'm thinking about all those things, you know. You can't wait till the last minute. And Brother Chuck Harrell will be here this year for homecoming. We're looking forward to having him. And that will be right after he's officially stepped down and retired as the pastor down at Chilhowee Baptist Church. And so I think that's going to be a big weekend. And I think we're going to be able to use Chuck and Linda, if she's feeling well, for several different things that weekend. That'll be a blessing to us. Then Dr. Shumpert's planning on coming for our mission meeting. He does a tremendous job for us. I want you to pray with this about this with us, and I'd like to meet with our mission committee next Sunday evening at about 5:30 if you're part of our mission committee. Not only are we doing well with our missions giving, we want it to grow. We want it to grow this year, and we want to be able to do more than we've ever done. But Dr. Shumpert, many of you know, he's in he has a lot of health challenges, and he wouldn't ever ask us for anything if it wasn't crucial. And he's expressed an interest, if it's at all possible, that we could fly him here from Columbia, South Carolina. He said, the trip nearly kills me, and it just takes it all out of me. But I believe we can do it. I believe we can help him find the right way to ticket, whatever it might be. And he is very a good steward. He'll do the right thing, but I think we can do it. So I'd like to be able to do that for him, and we'll talk about that with our mission committee as well as some missionaries we have. The last Sunday of the month, the doctor family that was at church camp, Mr. and I can't remember their last name, but you know the family that came to church camp with us from the Philippines, He's a doctor. She's a medical doctor. They came and had a great week at church camp with us. He's here in the States at Marietta Bible College, raising some support, taking some schooling to help him with his Bible teaching and preaching. And he did a great job for us. They'll be here the last Sunday morning of July. And I want our church to meet them because they have a tremendous ministry. It's a medical missions ministry. And they're not only in the Philippines. They go through all of Southeast Asia, Taiwan, Thailand, all over that part of the world with medical relief. But they share the gospel with everyone that they treat and minister to. It's a tremendous ministry. You're going to love them. They're fantastic people. And what a great investment they would be, and a unique ministry. So they're going to be here, and that'll be a great time. So all these things are ahead of us, even though we're in a great time right now. So be praying about them. We're going to take up our change offering for church camp. We want to do that, and we want to just be ready to go here and be starting to get ready for next summer. And we're looking forward to that. So these boys and girls are going to help us take up our offering here today. All right, well, let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for being good to us. We ask you just to bless the offering tonight. Thank you for summer camp this year, what it meant to those who were there. And thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to have camp. God, may you just give us faith to keep just stepping out and planning, scheduling, and just doing camp and just trusting you to meet the needs. And so we ask you to do that tonight. Thank you for these young men and women, these boys and girls that are here tonight. Bless them and Lord, help us to be a local church, God, that has the different ministries and opportunities they need to hear your word, and Lord, for a great biblical foundation to be laid for them. And so we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you have some change, just hold your hand up there. We're going to pick it up for you. Thank you. We appreciate that. Good job tonight. And I appreciate our orchestra doing a great job before services and during our change offering, and our choir. And I'm thankful for all the wonderful ministries we have here at our church. Appreciate the Salmons, Mark and Kathy, hosting our teenagers. And they're going to have a great snack tonight. I know why he did that. He was thinking snack shack and just put them both together. And that's kind of in his DNA, so that's what happened, wasn't it? Just a natural thing there that happened. But we are thankful, and we're glad you're here. It's been a great day, and we're so thankful for how God's working in families and lives and what he's doing today. Well, I'm thankful to have a Bible, aren't you? I'm thankful for the Word of God. I'm thankful that we have a God that we can be fully persuaded that He is able. And you can fill in the blank. Whatever you need, He's able. And so we're thankful for that. And I hope you'll take your Bibles tonight and turn to the New Testament book of Ephesians. And we're going to read just a verse of Scripture from the first chapter. Now, don't get excited. The pastor's only taken one verse of Scripture for a text. Don't get too excited about that. But one verse we're going to read, Ephesians 1. And you know I use a lot of Bible in my sermons. I like to use the Bible. I don't have anything to preach about if I don't use the Bible, do we? And I know some men maybe very rarely use it, but I have nothing else to say if I'm not preaching about the Bible, do we? And so we'll look at some other scripture. Ephesians chapter 1, families of faith believe in being faithful in Christ Jesus. That's an interesting phrase. I want you to see it here tonight. Faithful in Christ Jesus. Ephesians 1. We know Paul is being led of the Holy Spirit to write to the church in the city of Ephesus, a city he spent 3 years in, longer than any other place that we know of in his ministry at Ephesus for 3 years. And the Bible says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. The faithful in Christ Jesus. And we could say we're all in Christ Jesus. If you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you're in Him. He's in you and He's in me. But I want you to notice, please, it is the faithful in Christ Jesus that he's speaking about. And I believe families of faith believe in being faithful in Christ Jesus. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to meet together. Thank you for our local church. And Lord, we pray, Father, that we will, Lord, give close attention that, Father, all we do and all we are, that we're working to glorify you, that we want to grow in Christ's likeness, that we want to go and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray tonight that you'll speak to us and that God, as families of faith, will be faithful in Christ Jesus. And Lord, if there's someone here again tonight who's come to church and without Christ, maybe someone here tonight that is unsaved, they'll allow somebody to take a Bible and show them from the Word of God how to know that they have eternal life. That's what you want for them, Lord. And Lord, we pray for each and every one of us that know you as our Savior, that God, by your grace and long-suffering mercy, that Lord, we'll just step closer to you tonight. We'll walk closer with you tonight. God, your word will impact our lives. Lord, we'll realize right now, Lord, for these next few moments, God, that as we read your word, we're hearing from you. And so may it have, God, its fruit in our hearts and lives by faith. And so we thank you for all these things tonight. We ask them in Jesus' name and amen. Now, every scripture in the Bible is profitable to a born-again believer. Every scripture. We know that each word of our Bibles have been chosen by God Himself, and we believe the Spirit of God will use them as we put them into our hearts and lives and obey them. They will be used of God to do a great work in us, that through us He might do His work in the world that we live in. When you look at verse number 1 here in our Bible today, you see that phrase that I drew your attention to, faithful in Christ Jesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. I don't believe there's any group of people on planet Earth throughout all of human history who have done more true good or made more of a difference in the world than those that are in Christ Jesus and have been faithful in Christ Jesus. Those that have been faithful in Christ Jesus. There's been no group that have done a greater work in the world that's made more of a difference than they have. And there's lots of people doing good things that are eternal good things, But we can't forget that there are so many who are making this world a better place for millions to go into hell from. And that the greatest good is always going to be eternal good. And there's no greater group of people on the world in history who have done more real good and made more of a difference than the faithful in Christ Jesus. The faithful in Christ Jesus. You know, God spoke to the church at Ephesus again in a specific way. He did it in the book of Revelation. And you can hold your place in Ephesus. But in Revelation chapter 2, we find that he wrote to the church at Ephesus as one of those seven letters that were written to those seven real, literal, local churches. And he spoke to them again in Revelation chapter 2. Beginning in verse 1, he said, "Unto the angel of the church at Ephesus, write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works." Remember, this is God speaking. "I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee because thou have left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent." Now, this is good counsel to every church and every born-again believer. To repent, to repent. You know, the true Christian life is a lifetime of repentance. I repented of my sin debt one time for all time and was forgiven of that sin debt for once for all time. But I'm continually falling short. I'm continually walking away. I'm continually not obeying completely to the fullest. And I need continually to come back to the Lord day by day and say, "Lord, I'm sorry. That's something I should have done. That's something I shouldn't have done." And we have a God who's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But this is good counsel, that we are faithful in Christ Jesus to the very first work, the first work, the chief work, lifting up the Lord Jesus Christ so men and women, boys and girls can be drawn to Him. If we ever get away from that, then we're away from what our purpose is. And we're to do it in the love that Christ Jesus has shown us. That first love we knew, that love that was greater than our sin, that love by which we love Him because He first loved us. That's the way we're to do all we do. So it's good counsel. Back in Ephesians 1 in verse 1, he says of Paul that Paul is an apostle. The word apostle is a word that means a chosen servant, a sent servant. And Paul was an apostle. I want you to notice what Paul knew about that. He said, "I know this is true by the will of God." By the will of God. If we know we're in the will of God, then we can do whatever it is God would have us to do. If we know we're in the will of God, to know it. The will of God. I want to live my life in the will of God. I want to live in the will of God for my life. Paul was there in that city as a sent chosen servant of the Lord by the will of God. Ephesus was a filthy city. Not in the physical sense. Not in the physical sense. You know, if you get out of America, I'm shocked sometimes that other places I've been in the world, how clean they are. Now, they may not have the best of everything, but they can be clean. If you go to London, you're going to be shocked at how clean that city is. When we were in Ecuador, I've told you this before, you walk in the men's room down there at a gas station or somewhere along the road, there could very well be a woman in the men's room with a mop, a broom, some spray, and a cloth, And while you're in there using the bathroom, she's just in there cleaning the place out and sweeping around under your feet. And just that's just the way they do it. You know, it's not that way so much here in our country, is it? You just drive down the road and look at the trash and just the excess of America, the things we just throw away and discard. Ephesus was a filthy place, but not in the physical sense. It was one of the most spiritually wicked cities in the world. There was one of the largest false cults in Ephesus that you would find anywhere. There was a temple there to the goddess Diana. And literally what it was one of the largest houses of prostitution that the world ever knew. And it was all done in the name of worshiping their god. It was a filthy city. It was a godless city. And Paul went into this city. And you know, I thought about that because that speaks to you and I today of the day we live in, that even now, even though things are the way they are, we can still, if we're faithful in Christ Jesus, still make a difference. Paul went into that wicked city, a man who only knew the Lord. He knew he was called to serve. He knew that it was the will of God for him to be there. And with those things alone and the Word of God, he turned that city upside down. We can make a difference if we're faithful in Christ Jesus, if we're faithful in Him, if we're in the will of God. You read through the book of Ephesians in chapter 5, he says in beginning in verse 25, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church, gave Himself for it, that He might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the Word, that He might present it to Himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that He should be it should be holy and without blemish. You know, we can know the power of God in our lives, each and every one of us. We can know the cleansing, keeping power of the Word of God and the Spirit of God in our lives. We can know a new life. We can know a different life than before we knew the Lord. And we can be faithful in Christ Jesus. And we can know that Christ is in us. We can know that. The power of the Lord to cleanse us, to keep us unspotted and without blemish in this world, living for Him, serving Him, glorifying Him. In Acts chapter 19, and you don't have to turn there, but Paul recorded there how he first came to the city of Ephesus. In Acts 19, beginning in verse 8, the Bible said he went into the synagogue and spake boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. But when divers were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of that way before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. What a great work that God used Paul to accomplish. And I believe there's a great work that God is doing and can be done in our church and through our church now, today, just as it was in the city of Ephesus at that day. In Acts chapter 20, verse 31, the Bible said, therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God, to the word of His grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Now, the Apostle Paul spent 3 years in Ephesus. Geographically, he was in Ephesus. But the thing that made the difference was that he was faithful in Christ Jesus. Wherever we are, the geography doesn't matter. What's going to make the difference is, are we faithful in Christ Jesus? Faithful in Him. And we need to know where God wants us and know the will of God for our lives and be faithful in Christ Jesus. So let's look at just three simple things. And if you want to write the first thing down, it's just simply that thing that I've been repeating. Faithful in Christ Jesus. Be faithful to Christ Jesus. Be faithful to Him. Everything begins with Him. Everything begins with faith in Him. In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 12, the Bible said, "Giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of His dear Son, in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sin." If you're a born-again believer, you are in this world geographically, but you're also in Christ Jesus. You're also in Him. In Ephesians chapter 1, if you read down in the chapter and come down to verse number 20, the Bible said, "Which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and set Him at His own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under His feet and gave Him to be the head over all things to the church, which is His body, the fullness of Him that filleth all in all." Now, the Bible talks about a world to come. There's a world to come, an eternal world to come. And I need to understand, though, that as it is right now, I am in this world. But I'm also in that world with Christ. I'm already with Him because I'm in His heart. I've been graven onto the hands that He has. I'm in His heart, and I am in Him. And He is seated in that heavenly place. He is there at the right hand of God, awaiting the moment the Father will say, "Go and bring the children home." He's there. He is there, the head. He has a name above every name, of any name in this world or in the world to come. He is the head. He's the head. He's the head of the church. He, the head, is there, but His body is here, because His body is the church. The church. The church is mentioned 200 times in the New Testament. Never one time does it have the meaning of a building, or a structure, because that's not what the church is. I know sometimes I do that. We'll be driving by somewhere or some place, and we'll look over and we'll see a building. We'll say, "Oh, there's such and such church." No, not unless they're there. Not unless it's church time and the body of that local church is gathered together. Otherwise, the church isn't there. There's just a building there. The church is the body. The body is the church. Born-again believers that know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, who know it is the will of God for them to assemble themselves together in a local place. And there they are, the body of the Lord Jesus Christ in that place. And I understand today that the body of Christ is the church. He's the head. The head is in heaven. The body is here. The body is every born-again believer. We're a part of the body, this local church. I don't know what we are. We could be the fingernail on his hand. I don't know what part we are, but we're a part. This little local church is a part of His body, and He's our head. I know that my body can't function without my head. Maybe it would function better without it sometimes. I don't know, but we say sometimes we lose our head, you know, and when we do that, we do some crazy things, don't we? We do some crazy things. The body has to stay in constant contact to the head to function like it should. Everything has to be flowing and connected. Those electrical impulses have got to be firing, and everything's got to be communicating with one another, lest the body doesn't know what to do or can't do it like it should. A born-again believer lives in two worlds. We're delivered from the power of this world that we live in by our faith in Christ and Christ in us, and we have been translated into His eternal kingdom. We will live in that kingdom forever. But right now, we are His body in this world. His body, and He's our head. I'm to live to please Him. Isn't that what you do with your body? Your head tells it what to do. It obeys the head. We are displeased whenever a part of our body isn't doing what it ought to do, aren't we? And we'll go to the doctor and we'll go find out whatever we can so that that part of the body functions like it's supposed to. We'll do what the head tells it ought to do. And our bodies are built for the head to boss around, to give direction to. And our lives as the people of God, as the body of Christ, we're to live to please Him, to be used of Him, to be faithful in Him in all things, with all that we are, with all that we have. And this is how we grow spiritually. This is how we grow. When we consider that every day, we consider every day in all things, at all times, that we are His body in this world. We'll grow when we begin to consider that, when that never leaves our mind, no matter where we are, no matter what we're doing, no matter who we're around, if it never leaves our conscious minds that He's the head, I'm just the body, and the body's to please Him. The body is to serve Him. The body is to fulfill its function as He directs it, and let His word and will be our guide. And if we will make our goal of being used of Him in this world, then we're going to grow in a spiritual way. I believe the battery must have died, Evan. If you'll just pump this pulpit mic up just a little bit, that'll be good. So we find that we're in Christ and we're to be faithful in Him. We're to be faithful in Him. But then I want you to notice the second thing and just write down number two, faithful. Faithful to our spiritual family. We're to be faithful to Christ Jesus, but we're also to be faithful to our spiritual family. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 21, it says, "In whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye are also builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit." Now, the Holy Spirit is directing Paul to write here about building, about structures and framing, temples and habitations, but not in a physical sense, not with bricks and mortars and wood and nails, not with windows and carpeting or whatever it may be. No, he's talking here about you. He's talking about me that know the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. Ephesians 4, in verse 16, he said, "From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of it in love." Now, if we know the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we have a relationship with Jesus Christ that cannot be broken. We are His. We are His. If we know Him as our Savior, if we put our faith and trust in His finished work on the cross, if we've been born again by grace through faith, we are His. He and the Father have a covenant. The Father said, "I will in no wise cast out anyone that cometh to you." That is all inclusive. And now that I know Him, I never will ever be cast out away from Him. I'm His. I'm His. I have that relationship. He's my Father and I'm His Son. That's an eternal relationship that can never be broken. But our fellowship with Him must be worked at daily. Our fellowship. You husbands and wives know about that if you've been married for any length of time. You're married. Got the license to prove it, don't you? Got your names together on that mortgage, all those car payments, all that. You're in this thing together, see? But you have to work at the fellowship every day, don't you? Every day. You have to work at that. We have to work at that in our relationship with the Lord. And we also have to work at that in our relationship with our spiritual family. Our spiritual family, we have to work at that daily fellowship with them. Imagine what would happen
if we treated our own body, the parts of our body, if we treated them as sometimes family members treat other family members. Think about what it would be like if we gave no attention to some part of the body. Just think what it would be like if you went years without brushing your teeth. Teenagers, you're brushing your teeth, right? Just ignored them. Let them go. We all know the reality that sometimes family members don't always treat family members like we ought to. Think about what if we treated our body that way. We must be in the building business. And that means we need to be building one another. Building one another. We need to be building and edifying. We're to be fitly joined together so that ultimately as we work at that fellowship one with another, the Bible said so that we're compacted and joined so that every joint supplieth what the others need so that they will increase and be effectual and be built up and strengthened. We're to be working at that. We're to be faithful to our spiritual family. We often can do the most damage. And if you don't believe me, just go back and reread the book of James. We can do the most damage with the smallest member of the body. One of the smallest. That thing right between your gums. That tongue. It can do a world of damage. It can set the fields on fire with what we say, how we say it, who we say it to, the topics we speak about, all these things. We can do so much damage with that. We must be sure that we use it to the use of edifying. One of my favorite verses and portions is in Ephesians 4, and I often share it, but it's in verse number 29, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. That powerful portion of Scripture has everything to do with our speech. What we say, how we say it. Oh, we have to be faithful to one another. We have to be faithful in building up. That there's no maliciousness behind what we say. That we're thinking about what we're saying. And that if we're going to say it, that it ought not be able to be used in any way, no matter who it's about, but to build them up. And when other people hear us speak about others, whoever we're speaking to, they ought to see grace in our hearts. What are you talking about, Pastor? You know what? If you don't have anything good to say about someone, don't say anything at all. But if you're going to say something about them, find something good to say about them, whether they deserve it or not, because I don't deserve the grace of God. I don't deserve it. But if we're going to speak about people, then may others see grace in what we say, in our speech. How we speak to one another, the things we say about one another, how we regard one another, how we esteem each other. The Bible said we're to esteem others greater than ourselves. Now, it doesn't quantify or qualify them. It doesn't say if they're worthy of it, if they deserve it, if they're living right, doing right, acting right, speaking right. It doesn't say any of that. It just says esteem them greater than ourselves. View them that way. Regard one another with that regard that we have. We're family. See? I know many young people maybe wonder, or people maybe that come to a church like our church from other churches that are a little different. Why do you call one another brother and sister? See? I can't remember a time in my church experiences where I was ever at a church where we didn't do that. Brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so. I don't remember ever any time. But you ever wonder why? Because we're family, see? We have the same Father. We have the same Father. In a sense, we've all been birthed by the same mother, faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. We all made our way into faith in the family of God the same way, by faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone. And now we're all brothers and sisters in the Lord. That's why we do that. We do that because we're family. And we're to be faithful in Christ Jesus to one another, faithful to encourage, faithful to edify one another. The head wants what's best for the body. The head wants what's best for the body. You want what's best for your body. Because I know every one of you at the beginning of the year, your head says, I'm going to eat right and exercise, and I'm going to take care of myself this year. Your head wants what's best for your body. But the problem is, we don't always do what's best for our bodies, do we? But we don't have to doubt it with the Lord Jesus Christ. Our head, who is Jesus Christ, He truly wants what's best for us, doesn't He? He wants what's best for us. The Lord Jesus, our head. Some people have the reputation of being whatever, you name it, mean, hateful, hard to get along with, whatever it is. But you know, bodies, churches, have reputations. They also do. If anybody's lived in a community very long and you're around other bodies, they have a reputation. May the Lord help us that our reputation as a local body, may it always be that there's a love between those family members, that church, that there's a love between them that honors the Lord. That they seek to be faithful to one another, their spiritual family. Faithful to Christ Jesus. Faithful to our spiritual family. And then write this down, faithful to our work and purpose. Faithful to our work and purpose. In John chapter 20, this is one of the four gospel instances of the Great Commission. And then there's the fifth one we find in the book of Acts. John 20, verse 21, then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father has sent me, even so send I you. As the Father has sent me, even so send I you. See, the body has the same purpose and work as the head. We have the same. His purpose and work, the purpose and work of the head, is that of the body. We have a mission, we have a work, we have a purpose as the body of Jesus Christ in this world. And we must be faithful in Christ Jesus to that work. We must be faithful to Him in that purpose. You go over to Ephesians 6 and the 19th verse says, and for me that utterance, Paul's asking a prayer request. I'm always interested in the prayer life of Paul, and there's really not too many things that might be more helpful to you, whoever you are, than to study the prayer life of Paul in the Scriptures. The things he prays for as he prays for others. When he prays for the church at Ephesus or the church at Philippi, or he thanks God for what he knows about the church at Thessalonica, I'm interested in those things because I want my prayer life to be on the right track. I don't want to waste my time and God's time praying about things that isn't on the heart and mind of God. I want to pray for what is the will of God for you, for my family, for your family. Study the prayers of Paul. Here's a prayer request of Paul. Aren't you interested to know what he would have you pray that he might have become reality in his life? Notice he says, pray for me for me that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein, I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. That's what he was asking. Paul said, please pray for me that I'll have opportunities, utterance, that I'll have opportunities to utter a word for my Savior, to utter it. That word, that utterance, that makes me think about maybe Paul wasn't the most eloquent speaker. Some preachers are scalpels and others are sledgehammers, and we all fall in between. I don't think that Paul was necessarily the sharpest knife in the box, but he sure could lower the hammer when he needed to, couldn't he? He could get the message across. And this idea of utterance, to me, it encourages me, because there's sometimes maybe we don't have all this eloquent, all scripted out way to approach people to speak about the Lord Jesus Christ. But if we'll just utter a word for Him, then He'll use that, won't He? Just utter a word. Just get out a praise the Lord, or I'm thankful for the Lord, or thank the Lord for this or that. Just any time you can get in something for the Lord Jesus Christ, He'll use that. Paul said, just pray, I'll have boldness that when those opportunities come, I can just utter out something for my Savior, the Lord Jesus. That Savior, that head, Christ Jesus, He's ours. Just like He was Paul's, He's ours. And we must go into the world and make Him known. That's the work of the head. That's why He came. And the last thing He said was, now I'm going, but you must continue on. The head, His work is our work. And where we cannot go, we're to send those who can go and will go. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, He says in verse 9, for we are laborers together. Laborers together. Something as simple as passing out a flyer and inviting some little boy or girl to Vacation Bible School. That's the greatest work in the world. And we can be laborers together in that. Laborers together. You're God's husbandry. You're God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. May the Lord help us to build on our foundation of faith in Christ, that we are born again believers, and that by faith we know that we can know the will of God for our life. By faith we can have and know that there is a purpose for our life, that we can know and have a local church family like we have, that we together in faith can labor together for Him, uttering out a word for the Lord, passing out a gospel tract here, giving an invitation here wherever we can, daily giving attention to our fellowship, working at it day by day. And when we need to repent, we ought to repent. And when we need to forsake sin, we ought to forsake it. When we need to draw near to the Lord, we ought to draw near. And we ought to love our family. And we ought to esteem them greater than ourselves. May the Lord help us to be faithful in Christ Jesus. If you know the Lord, you're in Him. But may the Lord help us be faithful in Christ Jesus to the work, to the purpose that He has given us, laboring together with Him, laboring together with Him. Families of faith believe in being faithful in Christ Jesus, faithful in Him. Heavenly Father, we thank You today for Your grace and goodness. And Lord, we thank You for the opportunity, Lord, we have of being in Your family by faith through the finished work that Jesus Christ has done for us. And Lord, we thank You that He is seated today by Your hand. And Lord, someday He's coming back again for all that are His. And Lord, as the body of Your Son in this world, Lord, help us to be faithful in Christ Jesus, faithful to His work and purpose, and faithful to His family, our family, our spiritual family. Lord, maybe somebody here today doesn't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. I pray tonight they'd slip out of their seat and come. Lord, maybe somebody needs to, take a step of growth and just step out and say, I want to follow the Lord in believer's baptism. I want to live for Him, and I'm not ashamed to let people know He's my Savior. Maybe tonight the Lord's speaking to somebody specifically about His will for your life. There could be a young man here, the Lord may be speaking to you about being a pastor, preacher, missionary, and an evangelist. There may be a young lady here, the Lord speaking to you about a life of ministry. Won't you just step out tonight and come and just say, Lord, your will be done. I'd rather live in the will of God than any other place and be any other thing than to know the will of the Lord in my life. Maybe you're here today and it's that love and faith toward our spiritual family that we need to just ask the Lord to help us. Maybe it's the tongue that James wrote about that needs to be tamed. Maybe it's a heart and mind with motives and things that aren't pleasing to the Lord. Maybe we need to ask the Lord to give us His grace to forgive and cleanse us. Whatever it is, may we be faithful in Christ Jesus. Faithful in Him. Heavenly Father, we just ask You that, Lord, You would just have Your way in every heart, every life, that we'd all be obedient to You, Lord, and that, God, You'll be pleased in our hearts and lives. We ask it all in Jesus' name we pray, and amen. Why don't you stand together? We're playing 282 in our hymn book. You stand together, and let's sing that first verse together, and let's each be obedient tonight as the Lord leads in our heart and life. Hymn 282 in your hymn book. Let's sing the second verse, verse 2.
Just as I am in waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to Thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come.
Amen. We appreciate another great message tonight, and thankful for this truth about being faithful. And I appreciate that. It's a daily thing. We need to continue to come to the Lord and continue to be reminded about what He's done for us, and continue to yield ourselves to Him so we can be faithful to Him. He is faithful. And He desires that we'll be faithful to Him, be faithful in the Lord Jesus Christ. We're thankful for a great message today, again tonight. We're glad that you are here. We want our ladies to remember the ladies' Bible study tomorrow at 6 o'clock. We hope you'll come and be a part of that. And Lydia is hosting it at our house, so we hope you'll come and be a part of it. Our teenagers are getting ready to go and invade Andrea's house. So we're going to go and spend some time with her, and so we're looking forward to that. So don't neglect to pray for our teenagers. Before long, they have to go back to school and all those kind of things. It's no fun, but it's just a part of it. But we want to pray that the Lord will continue to use them and help them grow, and we'll just see Him glorified through our teenagers. So we're thankful for a great day, but we're glad you're here. We'll just pray and ask the Lord to bless what has happened today now, and that we can leave here and take these truths we've heard all day long, meditate upon them, allow them to be applied to our own life, and that we would be people that learn to cry out to the Lord and to stay faithful in Jesus Christ. So we're thankful for a great day. John, Marcel, will you pray for us, please, as we close?